or do not. There is no trap.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to another episode of Hey Mando, the Mandalorian wrap-up show we do here on the podcast. I'm Brad Hughes. I'm joined by my co-host, as always, Evan T. Boucher. Evan.
Hello there.
What's up, dude?
Nothing much.
This episode or chapter,
as well as the last couple chapters, have made me get like super nerdy. I've nerded out many times.
I have done nothing but eat a lot of food.
Well, yeah.
And watch Clone Wars and Rebels.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's all I've done.
How you spent Thanksgiving?
That's how I spent my, literally.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Which ties in perfectly to this chapter of Mandalorian.
I had a feeling. I started reading the book last week after I found the leaked title. Well, first, let's step back a little bit. How was your Thanksgiving?
It was pretty good, man. Pretty good.
Pretty good. What'd you do?
Got some good food over in, like, the Daytona Beach area at a locally owned place called Coastal.
Sweet.
So they normally, it's a seafood place, obviously, with that kind of name and location, but they had this like Thanksgiving meal special, so that was nice. They had pumpkin pie at the end for dessert.
Oh, that's
awesome.
And
that was delicious. So it was a good little Thanksgiving. I mean, it was my second Thanksgiving down here in Florida, so second one away from my blood family, but I spend it with other family that
nice.
I have down here.
That's beautiful. I, on the other hand, was in Venice.
Italy?
No, I wish. Venice with Holly's family, and we had a blast. Dude, I will say, there are parts of Florida that are wild.
I can imagine. Wild,
so,
as they say on that...
Wild! On History Hyenas. we were up there, and there's no mask mandate.
Really?
It's optional.
I mean, that's how it is here, too. But, like, people come into, like, where I work, and they're like, we don't have to. And I'm like, well, Subway says you do. And they're like, oh, we don't have to.
But see, that's the difference is that there's places that, like, in Orlando, you still have to because the store says
exactly.
It's our property.
It's private property. You have to.
That's not the case in Venice.
They're just like, do whatever you want.
We went to Walmart, and people wearing masks were the minority.
Wow.
Insane.
It sounds safe.
Insane. It was insane. It felt like time traveling. It was
We're never going back to normal, are we?
Yeah, we are.
With idiots doing this kind of
April,
stuff.
April, because I think this is a different conversation, but I think they're going to make this mandatory.
They better.
They kind of can't.
Let's throw people in jail if they don't. I don't know.
But,
it's like
but you can't,
extremes.
You can't force someone to do a medical procedure. Like,
no,
you can't force them. So it's kind of, but I think they're going to try. Anyway, that's a different conversation. But I get to the point. So my favorite restaurant is in Venice. It's called Tony's Chicago Beef. My number one favorite restaurant all time. I absolutely love that restaurant. If I had a choice of a last meal, it would be there. And it would be their Italian beef sandwich with cheddar cheese, dipped in gravy with hot peppers.
That does sound really good.
Oh, my mouth is watering. I ate four of them while I was there.
Whoa. All in one day?
Six?
No.
Maybe six. Might have been six.
Jeez.
When I was up there. Plus Thanksgiving. Your boy put on 6 pounds.
It happens.
I went off the rails. But this is a true story, and I don't want anyone to be offended by the story I'm about to say. So just if you're sensitive, just skip ahead a minute or so. But this is something that truly did happen to me. So, like I said, no mask mandate. I did this whole setup for this story. I get out of the car at Tony's, and it's a very small kind of like walk-up place. They have like some dining, but like not a ton. Like dining area. It's basically a to-go window. You get your crap and you leave.
Mm-hmm.
I get out of the car, and as I'm getting out, I'm putting my mask on. I'm walking towards this dude who's walking towards me. We're walking past each other. He looks at me. He goes, faggot.
Wow.
Because I had
a mask on.
Because he'd seen me put a mask. Unless he just didn't like my black t-shirt. Because I had a V-neck on. Could be that.
Maybe, yeah.
But he said that to me. And I just was like,
whoa.
And I looked behind. I looked at him. And I just kind of laughed to myself. And I don't want to get political, but he had a Trump sticker on his truck. Trump 2020. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah. That could
and
be
I
connected.
Was just like,
it could be connected.
I was
I'm not
just
getting
like,
political.
I got called faggot
for putting a mask on. And that's not even
so
saying
crazy.
Whether or not you believe in the mask. Then you personally, you just did it.
I don't
want to
wear
it.
Okay.
Yeah. None of us want to.
No one wants to wear a mask,
no.
Right? Like no one does.
Yeah.
But like, it's what they ask you to do, so just do it so we can get this shit behind us.
There's a lot
us.
Of things I don't want to do. I don't want to pay taxes.
Right?
I don't want to, but I do.
But you do, like, and it's just part of it.
Yeah.
But anyway, I thought that was insane. Wow. All right, this is where we're at.
I love how kind people are out there.
It's just crazy, man. I was just... Because part of it was like... Because you know me.
I'm surprised he didn't like say something back.
He was an older guy.
Okay.
If it had gotten physical, it would have been very bad for him.
Oh yeah, obviously.
And but I just was like, I'm like, what am I going to do? Beat this old dude's ass in this Tony's parking lot?
Dude, you sound just like Bill Burr. I've been like going on a deep dive on Bill Burr podcasts. Like
really?
At work, and because I'm at like out of sheer boredom.
He's the best.
And he had a story. It wasn't master later like this, but it was like
his old neighbor.
No, it was when a lady like opened her car door and hit his car.
Oh yeah.
And he's like, back in the day, I used to like say, hey, what are you doing? But now he's like, I just let it go.
What are you?
Like,
what are you gonna
what's
do?
What's gonna come out of it?
There's nothing positive.
They're gonna flip each other off and have a screaming match, and that's.
And
the
then
end.
You're gonna look like an asshole because you engaged this
both
old man.
Look like, yeah.
And if it got physical, I beat the shit out of an old guy, and then I'm gonna get sued.
No one wins there.
No, I mean, what's gonna happen? Nothing positive. Yeah. So I was
you
just
sound
like,
just like Bill Burr. That is crazy to me.
But it's true, man. I mean, seriously, if you go, okay, what are you gonna do? Say, excuse me, what'd you just say to me?
Yeah,
I'm not what you said, and that's really offensive. Like,
and even if I was,
you change that
like,
guy's
who
mind.
Cares if I am
even
gay,
if I am like, gay, like that's even worse that you said that. Like,
yeah.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, that's a Bill Burr right there too, man. Have you been like listening to him?
I've
too?
Listened to anything except History Hyenas.
Wow, I'm loving Bill Burr though. I'm going super deep on
his
him. Maybe he'll come back
best.
In Mando. All the other random characters have, just
See?
Not him.
I know he was filming something not too long ago.
Huh.
Around the time they were filming Mando, so maybe
who will come back first, Gideon or Bill Burr?
Gideon.
We'll see.
All right, so I want to introduce a new segment on this podcast. This is a Mandalorian wrap-up show. We're going to get to it in a second.
We'll get there.
But this ties in, and a new segment called Read Them, Have You.
Read Them, Have You.
Ooh.
Page-turners, they were not.
Page-turners, they were not.
Well, this one is. So I finished, it's an older book, and last week when we ended the, I told you about this, I was doing something for the show. I made a soundboard. Do you want to hear all the sounds we have?
Let's do it.
Before we get into this, Read Them, Have You. So we have the intro, which is play at the top.
Been around.
Then we have
Roger, Roger.
I like that.
Then
Imperial alarm.
This took me a long time to do.
I bet. Very nice.
For when someone says something horribly offensive,
we do a lot. We can do that for the lightsaber segment.
Put droid static.
Ooh.
This was just for you because you're gay.
Nice. Let's play that before I say it.
And then we have
a good question.
Hey.
For another time.
That's a good segment.
And then
too.
This is for when we're talking about people who don't like The Last Jedi.
Amazing. Every word of what you just said was wrong.
Man,
that's the best one.
Do or do not. There is no try.
This one's sarcastic.
Nice.
Oh yeah?
Good job.
There's another one
I've
for you.
I've come to rescue you, Master.
I'm sure you are.
I'm sorry, Ben.
Just for some good old... When you want to feel good.
Yeah.
Oh.
That's like nostalgic good.
It's so
like
good.
It's such a weird...
There's longer... There's more to it than that, but I just...
Well,
and then we got...
Star Tours,
yes,
even?
Yes, sir.
Oh, man.
Oh, I have that one twice on here.
What?
Oh, nice. Yeah, Vader.
That one's hard to clip out, but yeah.
It's, yeah, because it's so short. But if you know what it is, you know what it is. It's right there, too, after Vader says,
this is
what?
For people on Twitter.
The ability to speak does not make you intelligent.
Word.
This
Word.
One's my favorite.
Kylo Ren is a punk bitch.
I ran into Kylo in the bathroom.
He
told
said
me to
he had
give
an
you this.
8-pack.
He has an 8-pack. He's shredded.
Then we have
them, have you? Page turners. They were not.
At last we will reveal ourselves to the Jedi. At last we will have revenge.
Tatooine is sparsely populated.
Sparsely populated.
Ironic.
The Force will be with you, always.
This is a load of barnacles.
But why?
I had to do that one.
Why? Why would you do that one?
There's a few other ones. There's...
You suck!
From Futurama.
Yeah.
And then...
Got him!
And then my personal favorite...
These aren't even all Star Wars, but they're great. You should get the Ben, I always say his last name wrong, Ben Chong guy from the guy from Community. When he goes, huh, gay.
I haven't heard
you
that.
You should get that one.
Okay, done. I'll get it.
Yeah, you should get that one.
I'll get it. That's funny.
I watch Community like all the time, like once a day. I watch like 5 episodes, and that's one of my favorites.
I've never watched it.
He just goes, huh, gay.
Whoops. Stop it. I'm obsessed right now with... Where the hell? Oh, here it is. With Schitt's Creek.
I binged that whole series in like 2 days.
It's really good.
It's hilarious.
It's very funny. Daniel Levy is so funny.
Yes, he is.
Eugene Levy's funny too, obviously.
Yeah,
but
the father-son duo is great. And they like wrote the show too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He writes a lot of
episodes. Have you watched like the after shows they've done too?
I've only watched...
They're cool like 10-minute segments, but just like a round table of the actors talking about the show.
That's pretty
cool. It's great.
I didn't watch... So Holly started watching it, and I got into it watching it with her because I was like, who's that? What is the connection here? Like...
Moira's great too.
We're on season two, and it's like where, spoilers for Schitt's Creek.
It's been out for like a year or two now, so
it's been out. This is season two, so it's been out for a while.
It just wrapped up this year, but it's been out. But.
Yeah, it's where she's going back to work with the guy she broke up with, the veterinarian guy. And I was how do they know each other? And so like she showed me the first episode, which is hilarious, where they're losing everything.
Yeah.
And then so I just kind of continued in season two. I'm gonna go back and watch season one, but
I've only watched it once. I binged it in like 2 days, but it is amazing.
It's so good.
I'm not from Canada, obviously, but I'm from a small town, and they've nailed small towns.
Yeah,
that's like what Indiana is. I mean, I know it's not in Indiana, but that's Indiana.
Same thing.
Yeah, they've nailed it.
All right. Well, this is gonna be our segment where we do a book review. It's gonna be called.
Read them, have you? Page turners. They were not.
Sometimes they are,
they
and
could
this
be.
One and this one is the Ahsoka novel called Ahsoka. By E.K. Johnston. It's about 360 pages, I think, but it's in big font, so it's probably not that long. Probably
pictures?
Like
no pictures?
No pictures.
Dang. Star Wars books don't have pictures.
I think they should when they're choosing new characters,
Some
so you
should.
Can kind of see what
yes.
they look like.
Yeah, because I'm like, I don't know what this is.
Even
unless
if,
you
even
say
if it's just
species.
Like a, even if it's just like a reference at the end of the book.
Yeah.
Because we talked to Kevin Shinnick about that.
Footnotes or something even.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
We talked to Kevin Shinnick about that, and he's like, well, there's no real drawings of our characters.
Exactly.
I'm like, that's so strange.
Like, we don't know what Kara looks like.
No.
There's a concept on the cover.
Yeah, and he said
like,
that's not really...
That's not like official.
Yeah, so
yeah.
It's official, but it's not his character design, if that makes any sense whatsoever.
Yeah.
But the book is really good. I'm going to have you read it. I'm going to make you take it with you when you leave.
You're not going to have me. I'm just going to do it.
It's so good.
Really
I'm looking at it over there. The cover's awesome.
Yeah.
I read this book. I'd had it, and I had set it aside because there was other things I was reading to get ready for the episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker. And I wish I'd have read it when it came out because there was so much cool stuff in that book. I don't want to spoil it, but I think if you're an Ahsoka fan, it's a must read.
Which everyone is now because of Mandalorian.
Yeah.
So,
which is weird to me.
She's mainstream officially now.
That's so strange, right?
Yeah.
Anyway,
it's
cool. It's cool, but
yeah,
it's just weird that Ahsoka Tano was like a mainstream character.
In 2008, you would have told people that,
right? That she's gonna be like the main focus of like the show going forward. That's a live action. People wouldn't have believed you.
No.
I don't know if she's the main focus, but I think she's gonna. We'll talk about it when we get to there. But if you're an Ahsoka fan, definitely read this book. It's really good. I just love E.K. Johnson's writing style. She does a great job of doing a story that isn't like high stakes necessarily, but like just really well done. And this is one of those books where it's kind of like it honestly reminds me of The Mandalorian because she kind of flees, goes to another place, helps save everybody, and then flees.
Okay.
Kind of.
Yeah.
You'll
that's like her whole character is whenever she sees someone that needs help, she helps them.
She's the Mandalorian.
Yeah.
But it's an older Ahsoka. This is after everything that's happened to her.
We've seen until Mando.
Yes.
Yeah.
I can't nail down where this takes place. Because I looked it up, and there's two different... I got two different answers.
If you use the lightsabers as, like, reference points, that could help you.
Yeah.
I don't want to, like, spoil it.
Yeah,
but
and
yeah.
that's kind of how I had to figure out where this was, because it's...
Yeah.
Then it's definitely before Rebels.
Okay.
Because she has those lightsabers in Rebels.
Right.
And she doesn't have lightsabers for most of the book.
Okay.
Or she has... No? I think...
Well, because after Clone Wars, she only has one.
I think she... I read this thing so fast. I read the book in a day and a half.
Wow.
Yeah, it's really good.
Yeah.
Page Turner, it was. I mean, it was fantastic.
That should just be like how you review it. Be like, instead of like 1 out of 10, 5 out of whatever, be like, Page Turner, it was. Page Turner, it was not.
I should make another sound effect where it goes, Page Turners, they were.
And they were.
Like, cut it out.
You could splice it out. Yeah.
And that'll be my rating system. Page Turners,
that's all
they
you
were
need.
Not. I still can't finish Alphabet Squadron.
I can't finish
I
Aftermath.
I can't do
so.
It. I'm going to try to read Shadowfall.
Page Turner Aftermath is not.
I told you, dude. It's rough.
And there's three of them, and I've only read one, and I'm like, I can't.
Audiobook.
Maybe.
You can
put
knock
me to
it
sleep.
Out easier. But you can multitask. You can be doing
sleep.
Stuff. And
yeah.
Yeah. I've done that many times. But Page Turners, you should definitely check out that Ahsoka book. And it's paperback now, so it's not expensive. So go on Amazon and check it out and support E.K. Johnson because she is a badass writer. I want to see her do something. I like her writing style so much. I want to see her tackle something a little bigger Because even the Queen's Shadow books and Queen's Peril, they were both smaller stories, but they were necessary. Because now when you go back and watch, after reading those, you go back and you watch the scenes with the Handmaidens, and it just seems so much more. Have you read either one of those?
No, no.
I think you'd like them. Again, they're smaller stories. They're YA novels.
Yeah.
But for some reason, the Star Wars books just work really well in YA.
A lot do. I didn't like Crash of Fate, but I do get the appeal.
You didn't like Crash of Fate?
No.
Oh, I really like that
I get
book.
The appeal of it, so I understand.
I liked it a lot. It was a cool little romance story. I dug it. I'm a sucker for that kind of stuff. Whereas my niece says a stucker. You're a stucker. You're supposed to say stinker and sucker. She came out stucker.
You're both of those things.
I am. All right, so let's talk about Mandalorian.
Well, before we get there, I did want to have a correction we had from previous Mandalorian discussions.
Oh, yeah. This
where
is
we talked about Bo-Katan being the first live-action animated crossover
we
character.
We messed up. We did.
Yikes.
We messed up.
Yeah. It was actually Saw Gerrera,
yeah,
who was the first live-action animated crossover.
I forgot
not
about that.
Not played by the same actor, of course, but still. He was in Clone Wars at the end of season five or six, the Onderon arc. And then he, from there, translated over to Rogue One, played by Forrest Whitaker. And now he's in Fallen Order, also voiced by Forrest Whitaker.
He was in Fallen Order?
Yeah.
Saw Gerrera was?
Yeah, on Kashyyyk.
How do I forget that? Oh, that's right.
Yeah, briefly on Kashyyyk.
Yeah.
So he was technically the first, and then Bo-Katan, and now here we have Ahsoka. And also another correction, not really a correction, but I feel like we just didn't talk about it because there was so much to unpack from Chapter 12, The Siege. At the end, the, I guess, battle droids, whatever you call it, that Moff Gideon has, those are dark troopers.
What are dark troopers?
They're brought from Legends, the old EU. Essentially, they're, we don't know if it's confirmed in the new canon, but the old canon, they were made of a metal called Frick, which is essentially just another Beskar. So they could bring that in to have them being made of Beskar. So if these battle droids are made of Beskar, like the former Dark Troopers of Legends were made of Frick, that could be tough for Jedi to fight, Ahsoka to fight.
Mm-hmm.
It could be tough for Mando to fight. And it could just give him all the more incentive to like try to reclaim that Beskar.
Mm.
So I don't know if they're made of that metal, but we do know they're called Dark Troopers because in the audio description of the episode, it says Dark Troopers.
There's an audio description on Disney Plus?
I don't know where it's at, if it's on Disney Plus or where it's at, but yeah. It's like subtitles, but on steroids.
Huh.
So they
great.
Are dark
Another,
troopers.
I have to watch episodes three times now
yeah.
just to get the whole thing. Great.
Yeah. So.
Interesting.
Something we missed, but I felt like we had to talk about it. And
right.
also from The Siege, not directly involved in that chapter, but there is history in canon of Force-sensitive blood with midichlorians being transfused into non-force-sensitive beings.
In canon?
In canon.
Where?
Sifo-Dyas actually used some of his blood for General Grievous to keep him alive and save his life.
Where's that in canon?
One of
some
the comics
comic
somewhere, yeah.
Oh,
obviously, it didn't make
then.
Grievous Force-sensitive. So, I don't know if that was their intent, but it did not make him Force-sensitive, but it did save his life. So, there has been an instance of midichlorian blood transfusions before.
Interesting. All right, let's talk about Mando Chapter 13, The Jedi. So I've watched this thing four times now.
Two and a half for me.
I watched it once when it came out because we were going to watch it together.
Right.
But I was just like, because we were sitting here the other day and I saw the title, The Jedi, which
yeah.
is what it was. When that's what
during that
during
episode,
the show,
you saw it.
I almost said it, but yeah. I'm glad I didn't. But it was right. That's what I had saw.
Well, somebody saw that Thursday night and they're like, oh, I saw it. And I was like, don't tell me. And they're like, well, if you guess, can I say you got it right? I was like, yeah, sure. I'm like, is it called The Jedi? And they're like, yeah.
Yeah, it's so like, it's not like a, I mean,
yeah.
duh.
We knew Ahsoka
coming.
Was
coming. We knew she was coming.
But Ahsoka's not a Jedi, so
that's
why?
The thing, but they kept calling her a Jedi and she didn't.
But the Magistrate doesn't know she's not a Jedi.
But she's always corrected people.
I know, and when I thought the Magistrate said, show yourself Jedi, and Ahsoka emerges from the fog, I thought
I'm
she was
no
going to say, I'm no Jedi.
Yeah.
But she didn't. So she's aged. Time has passed. Characters can change and develop. So maybe she's developing and changing and kind of embracing the good parts of being a Jedi.
Yeah.
She might be a Jedi again.
We will break down the episode like we typically do, but I wanted to talk a little bit about Ahsoka up front before we break down the episode. So, did it feel like Ahsoka to you?
Yeah.
First time I watched it, it didn't to me.
Really?
But then I have to remember, she's a kid when we've seen her. She's a child.
I mean, at the end of Rebels, she's not a kid.
But she's still like...
20s.
She's maybe younger. 30s. She's
20
not,
or 30s.
Is she that old?
Well, we don't actually know. The very last scene of Rebels, when she shows up in that white cloak
with the staff,
we don't even know when that takes place. That could take place right now. That last scene, technically, we don't know when that takes place.
Wait, what?
Like, there could have been a time jump.
What white cloak? I'm not remembering. When she's I just finished
the staff.
I just finished that the other day.
In Rebels?
Yeah, where Thrawn and the space whales go on the Star Destroyer. Spoiler.
Yeah. And well, that's the last we see Ezra and Thrawn. But the last we see of Ahsoka walking up to Sabine, we don't know when that takes place. That could take place right now in Mandalorian time. It could take place in the middle of the original trilogy. We don't know.
I didn't go back and watch that part. I don't even remember that scene. I know the picture because I was like, when the magistrate first goes, here's the staff. My brain was like, is that the staff from Rebels? Because I didn't remember what it looked like.
They're not.
It's not. No, I looked it up.
But that's a good thought.
But I remember that picture.
Yeah.
And that's why
one's a spear, one's a staff.
Yeah. And it looks like the thing from The Last Crusade.
Yeah, it really does. No, or from... not
Last Crusade.
First Indiana Jones. The Holy Grail. Not Holy Grail. Wow, we are dumb.
Why can't we think of this? I know.
Ark of the Covenant.
Yes.
Yeah.
Is that what it's called?
Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Raiders of the Lost Ark. Jesus fucking Christ.
It's called the Staff of Ra.
Staff of Ra,
I can tell you that, but I can't tell you the title of
the name of the first Indiana Jones movie.
Jeez.
Jesus Christ.
This is not an Indiana Jones podcast.
No.
No.
It's a Lucasfilm kind of podcast. One aspect of Lucasfilm. This episode we're talking about Red Tails. No.
Looking at Lucasfilm did do a Red Tails episode.
Did they?
Recently. Yeah.
No, I've never
Have you
seen
heard
that.
They're splitting the show? It's is it Dan? Dan Z, right?
Dan Z.
He's no longer going to be on it. He's doing other projects.
Weird.
Yeah. I'm going to miss him.
Yeah.
But
I know that guy. He's a good dude.
Yeah. I can tell from listening.
Jim's
still going to be involved, though. Jim's a great dude.
He's the best. Met him with at Star Wars Galactic Nights.
Nice.
He knew who I was. It was weird.
Wow.
It was weird.
That is kind of weird.
It's a weird moment.
Yeah.
So strange. Anyway, he was supposed to come on the show like 7 times. It just never worked out. It just never worked out.
He just wrote a book, too. He wrote a Star Wars book. Like,
I mean, he writes for Star Wars. He's also a teacher. He does his own podcast. He did the gym. He's busy as crap.
Yeah.
But and I'm going to go on his at some point, and I assume you will, too. But anyway, what were we talking
about? The staff that Ahsoka has.
Anyway, so
the end of Rebels could take place in the middle of the original trilogy. It could
take place now.
We don't know.
Interesting.
So
the first time I watched it through, when she was actually fighting, I was like, yes, queen. Yes. Yes, queen. Give me that.
When you watch it with women, that's the reaction they have to.
Really?
So
she was badass, dude. I watched it the first time. I watched it immediately again, and then I watched it once with Holly again that night, and then I watched it yesterday with my dad.
Nice.
And it was very interesting watching it with my dad because I was like freaking out with certain things, like the
reveal
at the end.
He probably doesn't know who Ahsoka
is. No idea who Thrawn is.
Or Thrawn.
He knows who Ahsoka is, but he doesn't know much about her. So I was like, basically what you need to know is that she was Anakin's apprentice and thought he died.
That's
in War 66.
The bare minimum.
And then I was like, watch this fight scene from Rebels. And I showed him the thing. He's like, dang.
What fight scene is it?
The one.
Maul, or?
No. The one where she fights Vader and finds out
it's
Anakin.
Oh, you said Rebels. You said, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Finds out it's Anakin. I'm like, that's heartbreaking. That whole moment is just insane.
Yeah. And like always, we're jumping around, but she brings a little bit of Anakin up.
Mando. She does.
Not by name. She won't mention his name.
She's a my master or something.
Yeah.
She's like the best of us.
I know
best
of
us.
Yeah. Attachments have brought
down the
best.
I thought she said Anakin at one point. Didn't she say the name?
No, she doesn't ever say Anakin.
No, okay.
Yeah.
So I didn't like it at first. It was Rosario Dawson. Like we knew. I didn't want it to be.
None of us really wanted it, but I had made peace with it. And I was like, it's fine. It'll be okay.
She's badass.
And it works.
She does a great job of filling in these like iconic characters. And
I've never seen her in anything.
Yes, you have. You've seen her in Guardians of the Galaxy.
Rosario Dawson?
Yeah, dude.
She's in Guardians?
Yeah, she's what's her name?
Who?
Gamora, right?
No, she's not.
Is that not the same person?
No, that's from Avatar. The blue chick from Avatar.
I thought that's the same person.
No.
Oh.
Nope.
Well, I completely am wrong here. What else has she been in? She's been in other stuff.
I think she was in Clerks, is what I heard. I don't know. I haven't seen
her. I thought this was a chick that played Gamora.
No.
Oh. I'm thinking of some other. Who's that?
I forget her name. It's like, not Zendaya, but it has a weird like name like that. It's, yeah, I forget. But she's also in Avatar, the main chick in Avatar.
Sin City, Zombieland, Men in Black 2, Trance, Zookeeper, Unstoppable.
This is Rosario?
Yeah.
Okay, I've seen Zombieland. Who is she in Zombieland?
I don't know. Zombieland, Double Tap.
Oh, I haven't seen the second one.
Death Proof, that's where I know her from, Quentin Tarantino. Rent, Eagle Eye, she's in Eagle Eye. I'm pretty sure she was also in Daredevil the show. Jay and Silent Bob, Ratchet and Clank, she was a voice in. I'm pretty sure she was in Daredevil. She played like the nurse in Daredevil.
Zoe Saldana.
Yeah, that's what I thought this was.
Yeah, Zoe Saldana is Gamora and also Avatar Blue Lady.
Yeah, she plays Claire Temple in Daredevil. I knew her from that.
Okay.
All right, well, I'm an idiot because I thought it was the chick that was Gamora and stuff. And I was like,
no,
that's
Zoe Saldana.
Okay, that's so, who okay. I thought Rosario Dawson was.
It happens.
But then I remember that she was in Daredevil, and I remember my dad being like, I love her. Anyway, I thought she did a great job.
Yeah, I think she gets all the subtleties of Ahsoka down, a lot of like head nods, the stance, a lot of eye movement. Like, you can just see it in her face that she's been through some stuff.
Yeah.
And Ahsoka has been through some stuff.
She definitely has.
So you can see it just by
she's one of the most troubled characters in Star Wars.
Yeah, but she handles it probably the best of anybody. Like, Anakin and Kylo have been through a lot, but they do not handle it well.
No,
they handle it. I think Ahsoka handles it probably, yeah, easily the best we've ever seen.
I would agree that
Kylo Ren is a punk bitch.
How dare you? The soundboard is going to have to go after a while. That part, it's going to have to go. I love that. Saturday Night Live. I love that.
Oh, so good. I told you the thing that they had planned.
Matt, the radar technician.
I told you the thing that they had planned, right?
No.
For that sketch?
Uh-uh.
And that Lorne Michaels was like, we're not doing that?
No, what is it?
It was Horatio Sanz was on some
the
Mithril. I'm sorry, not Horatio Sanz. That dude that's in that sketch.
Oh, he's
Bobby
in
Moynihan.
Galaxy's Edge. Yeah,
Bobby Moynihan.
Not the VR game. And he's also in Resistance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's done a lot of... He's a big Star Wars fan, so good for him. They were planning... When they wrote the sketch, they had planned to have a shot in the show where there's two stormtroopers that are mopping up a floor. And as they're like, oh, finally, we're done. We can go home. Han Solo's body splats down and from...
Dang. Oh, that would have been dark. That would have been so dark. I would have been okay with it, though.
It would have been
that's
funny.
Saturday Night Live is the place for that.
For that.
100%.
Oh, 100%.
Is for that. I would have been okay with that.
Oh, so funny. But,
jeez.
But, yeah, so crushed it as Ahsoka. Was the, was her hair, the tails? I forget what they're called.
That's what I'm trying to,
was
head
it CGI?
Tails. No, I don't think they were, but the
sometimes
length of
they
them are all over the place.
Sometimes they looked... That's why I'm wondering if it was CGI.
I don't know. I'd imagine like maybe some action scenes when they're flying all over might be. But like stationary acting scenes, I feel like it was like an actual practical
headpiece.
But
there were parts of it where it looked fake.
Yeah.
And the only explanation for that would... Well, not... I was the only explanation for that would be because it was fake. That's not always true because sometimes like...
Well, they're fake no matter what. Because they're not really her
headpiece.
Well,
I mean practical is what I mean by fake.
Yeah.
Practical, like on her body, like a physical headpiece.
Yeah.
But sometimes like you can take a photo and it looks fake,
exactly.
But it's real. So I don't know. But it looked, there was like an uncanny valley to it at the beginning of the episode especially. It kind of, maybe it's just I got used to it.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like they were CGI. And I could be way off on this. It just doesn't look real.
Yeah, I don't know. I kind of get that. I moved past it because I mean I was more.
Oh,
focused.
I don't care.
Yeah,
I just was like, ooh, I wonder if it is.
It ruined the episode, but
I also think too they probably would have done it CGI so that way no set photos got leaked.
Yeah,
because I mean they probably had her face. They probably had her face and her arms, the orange, right?
Yeah,
but I wouldn't be shocked if they like did that in post.
Yeah, I could believe that, but I mean I'm just gonna take it as just it's how it's been interpreted into live action. But the length of them don't match the length that we've seen at the end of Clone Wars.
But isn't she
somehow
growing?
Shorter.
But if she's growing, couldn't she be growing into them?
Dude, I don't know how that works. Because we see them get longer over her lifespan in Clone Wars.
Oh, really?
And now it's like they're short again.
Oh, who
so
knows?
I'm just going to take that as just that's how it's interpreted.
Maybe you can
in live
cut them.
Action. Maybe they grow back. Maybe it becomes.
Maybe it's like an exaggerated thing for the style. And then when you put
it
in real life. Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. It's just the art style. Yeah. So I'm not. That didn't bother me at all. I've seen people that were freaking out. It doesn't make sense. They're not the right length. They're
guys,
12 and a half inches
relax.
Instead of 13. Like, okay. Shut up.
Relax. Relax.
Yeah.
All right.
But we were told by Bo-Katan it was going to be a forest planet. And it is a forest planet.
Oh, that's
but
right.
We're
thinking.
I was thinking like Endor, something like that.
Corvus is one of my favorite Star Wars planets.
It's cool looking.
That
now
whole
that I've seen it.
Scheme, color scheme, like that green smog looking.
Yeah, it's like a combination of like Mustafar and like Endor.
Yeah, it's exactly what it is. Yeah. It's like if Endor was on fire.
Yeah.
It looks awesome.
And I'm intrigued to see how the planet got this way. If it's the Empire that did this, if it's the Magistrate. She doesn't seem like the best person, so maybe it's her.
I want to know where she... Because they talk about it in the show, that she was like a part of in the Clone
Wars.
Her name
is Morgan Elsbeth, so and they mention her being involved in like Clone Wars or something, but she's a made-up. She's new.
Oh, she's new. Yeah, I was like, what if that's like in the visual dictionary?
I was like, oh, this could be cool. It's someone we know, but no, just a random person that was around in the old times.
Another rando person.
Another new random planet, another new random person. Fun. Fun stuff. I mean, I like the design of the planet, so I'm not saying that. It's just another new planet. Like, add it to the long list.
Yeah.
But I was thinking, yeah, like an Endor-looking planet or like a Jen Kloss planet, but it's like nothing like we've seen.
I like it a lot.
Yeah.
I like the spin on it.
Yeah.
So let's go ahead and start breaking down the episode. Overall, I liked Ahsoka, the look of it a lot. I thought it was really cool. I thought it was well done.
Yeah.
I think she nailed it.
Yep.
But let's jump into the actual episode itself. Go for it. Because I'm looking for something here.
Yeah, we had it jump straight into with Ahsoka being a badass, like we've mentioned, killing all these people in the forest.
Was not expecting that.
No, I was expecting it to be a slow build, and we'd see her like in the second half of the chapter, maybe, or the halfway point of the chapter. But nope, we just jump straight in, and it's not like a reveal. It's not like we see this hooded figure and we don't see her face and we see her fighting. It just from 5 seconds into it, you know it's Ahsoka, so that's pretty sweet. And then the magistrate reveals herself and like talks to Ahsoka, and Ahsoka's like, "You have one day to give me what I want, or I'm going to come in there and kill all you guys," basically.
Mm-hmm.
And
why did she give her a day?
I don't know. Because Ahsoka could easily just jump over that wall and massacre all those people. And that's kind of a small issue I have with this chapter is, like, did she really need Mando's help? Did she really need it? Like, come on.
Well, here's the thing. I think she may just wanted backup.
Yeah, but does she
need
it?
But the whole thing is that he's there to give the child to her.
Yeah.
So he may as well.
Well, he's there. He might as well help. And like, also, what are the odds he shows up in that one day time period where it's like she's going to go in and kill these people?
That's how scripts work, my dude.
Yeah. Like, you can't show up small nitpicks, tiny small nitpicks happen. Yeah.
Well, see, so, we don't know how long she's been there fighting.
That's exactly what I'm saying. Like, has she been just chilling in the woods for 5 years and now she's going to go raid him?
No. Or it seems like they know her. They know that her capabilities are. That's why they have thermal scopes and shit.
Yeah.
So they know what she's capable of.
She's been casing out
this
city for a while
now.
For sure. Okay. That's cool. So, I mean, small minor nitpicks, but she gives him a day.
I wouldn't call it a nitpick. I would just go, that's the plot of the story.
Okay. That makes sense. So she gives him that day ultimatum. And the magistrate and her little guard
guy. That was the only thing I was confused about.
I don't know why she gave him a day. If she's trying to be like, hey, like, I don't want to kill you guys.
I guess that's probably what it would be. Like,
because the magistrate is like, I won't give up any information. And Ahsoka's like, I won't give you that choice.
What is information worth to you? One life? Two lives?
Ten lives.
These people's lives are meaningless to me. Like,
and
damn,
Ahsoka's
son.
Already like, they're already suffering under you. Yeah, so it's not like it's going to be any better.
Yeah.
Like, so.
I love the look of, when we get to the fight, her little villa she's got.
Oh,
behind,
her compound herself.
Dude, unbelievably
beautiful. Such a stark contrast, too, from the
it
village.
It looks like Doc Ondar's.
Yeah, kind of, yeah.
The building looks just like Doc Ondar's
to
me.
Yeah, but outside it's got like a Japanese like koi pond
Zen garden
feel.
And all
Zen
that
garden,
stuff.
Yeah.
I love the
it's
whole
beautiful.
Look of it. It's one of the more, like, especially with the water.
Yeah.
And like you can see the lightsabers reflecting off in the water.
Yeah.
Oh, unreal. All right, let's get back to, sorry.
So then she leaves, Mando is flying in then on the Razor Crest, and for now we'll call him Baby Yoda, because eventually we'll get to his name, but at this point he's Baby Yoda.
The child.
The child. We see
I
him.
Can't stand people calling Baby Yoda.
That's true. So we see the child wanting that little spherical top piece to like a joystick, and Mando's like, get back in your seat, I'm starting the landing process. And he's like, hey kid, I said get to your seat. Like, you can see him being a dad. Mm-hmm. It's like typical, like this is what a dad would do
it's
with his
like
kid.
My kids, they don't listen.
No kids listen, so it's okay. But we see the child. Sorry, I'm not going to call him BY anymore.
You don't have to.
No, that's true. So the child starts using the force to unscrew that spherical top piece. We don't see him actually get it, but you know he's going to get it. So then they land on Corvus, and they disembark the Razor Crest, and the child's holding that little top to the joystick. And Mando's like, that needs to stay on the ship. So he takes it from him, and he puts it in his pocket. And that's going to come up later in the chapter. So it's like, why didn't he just go put it back on the ship?
Such a small little but thing that, like,
it didn't have to.
I wonder if that
anything.
Was written on purpose, like, in as a story plot, like, you take, or
it
if it was like,
it would have to
just
be.
Like banter, and then he's like, oh, I could use this as the connection thing.
I bet he did it intentionally, because it was kind of a big deal for the child in season one. Like, the child wanted it. For like
and that's
two or three
why he
chapters.
Ends up. That's why he ends up going back for him. Remember, he goes to grab.
Yeah,
that
he
thing,
looks at it. Yeah,
and he's like,
yeah, he's like, all right, I'll go back. Yeah,
that was such a sad moment.
It was, but in a good way though. Yeah. He's like deciding that he's like, yeah, I'm kind of a good dude. I should probably go back. So then Mando walks up to the gate, and they ask him, he's like, you're a bounty hunter, right? And he's like, yeah. And they're like, are you with the guild? He's like, last I checked. So it's like, he's kind of being a badass. Like, he's not really anymore.
No, he's not. That's the thing.
So he's straight up lying to him.
He's lying.
But technically, he is still a part of the guild.
Because if they verified it with Greef Karga, he'd be like, yeah.
He'd be a part of the guild. So he's not lying, but he's
not a bounty hunter at this moment.
Yeah. So they let him in. And the magistrate's like...
It's like the cast members at Disney who are cast members, but you're not working.
But they're not. Ouch.
But you're not working. Jesus Christ, I'm sorry.
okay, Bill Burr. So the magistrate is like, hey, I got a problem. This Jedi is trying to come in here and kill us. Like, can you go take her out for me? And he's like, my price is pretty high. Like, that's not going to be an easy kill. And that's when the magistrate reveals she has this spear that's made of Beskar.
So dope.
That's really sick. And he can tell it's Beskar from just, like, seeing it. He knows what it is. And he never agrees to killing her, if you notice. Like, he's like, I will find her. Like, where is she?
Mm-hmm.
Like, so he doesn't agree to kill her. So he's not lying yet again. Like, he's keeping to what he's saying. So I don't know. That's probably intentional when they wrote the script, I would imagine. But he's not lying, and he's keeping his word. He's keeping with his code.
Mm-hmm.
So they tell him where to find Ahsoka. So he goes out in the forest, and we see... kind of in the, I don't know, like left corner on one of the trees, we see a Convor.
Yeah.
And that's got to be Mor-Ai.
100%. It has to be. Yeah. I thought the same thing when I saw that.
I'm glad it wasn't like, let's have it fly across the camera or make it obvious.
It's just very subtle. There.
Yeah. And it's always, Mor-Ai is always with Ahsoka. She's always around.
So I know what that is, but what is the significance of that? Because I don't know that.
I don't know if it's confirmed, but a lot of people think it's the daughter from Mortis.
Mm.
And it represents Ahsoka being like the daughter.
Huh, interesting.
In that aspect of the Force. But if it's not her, it's just a Convor that hangs out with Ahsoka. Okay. So either way, it's been with her since sometime in Clone Wars and in Rebels. So just a Convor that always hangs out with Ahsoka. But gotcha. It could be the sister, because she does take different forms. It's in the World Between Worlds episode.
I watched that again, and I didn't hate it as much the second time.
Yeah, I don't love it still, but it's whatever. But
I mean... You can't do it again because the temple fell.
What if it comes up in Mando, though? Like, ugh.
Temple fell, though.
What if it's on Tython?
No. I know Please what that's no. going to be. I have a very good feeling about that.
Okay, good.
I know exactly what it's going
to
be.
We'll get that to that, too, later, but that's not a new planet, thankfully, for once. It's already in canon. It exists. So, thankfully, it's just not...
I thought it was sounding familiar.
Yeah, it is. So, we'll get there eventually. So... Ahsoka... sneaks up on Mando, and we have this cool little fight. It's kind of like when he meets Cara Dune.
It's
kind of like that fight.
It's exactly the same kind of thing.
They're trying to both kill each other. Like, so Mando used the flamethrower. Oh, well, before the flamethrower, we see the Beskar armor block Ahsoka's lightsaber blades.
Didn't we know that, though, already?
We knew that, like nerds like us. Okay. But it's never been said to, like, casual fans. So
gotcha.
That was probably like a, oh, holy.
My dad was like, whoa.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah Beskar
can
doesn't...
block. You can't cut it with lightsabers. I mean, you can
what about
after
the dark
it's lost
saber?
In its integrity. Same. You
Same.
Can.
Okay.
Yeah. So that was like a reveal for casual fans. But it just also confirmed something we already assumed. Because it's never really been stated outright. But we.
But that would be why they have it against the Jedi.
Exactly. Because the ancient Mandalorians fought ancient Jedi. Yeah. That was the biggest battle in the galaxy.
Of having the Beskar.
Yeah. Everything the Mandalorians built was to combat the Jedi.
Yep.
I mean, even in Clone Wars Season 7, the sarcophagus they put Maul in. It's the only one left because Satine destroyed all of them. But that sarcophagus blocks force powers. Like, Maul can't use the force while he's in that.
I don't know what that is. I haven't seen that.
It's Season 7. You've seen that, right? At the end of Clone Wars Season 7 when they capture Maul on Mandalore.
I need to go back and watch it because I watched it when it came out and I don't remember what you're talking about.
Gotcha. But yeah, so when they capture him, they put him in this, basically sarcophagus.
Her Ahsoka's arc on that was terrible. Season 7.
Her arc in Season 7?
The episodes that focus on her with
the Spice Girls?
Dude.
Yeah.
It was so boring.
I hate those episodes too.
I got out of I've watched the first one and the second one I was just like, this is weak.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So yeah. So that was a sick moment of seeing the Beskar block the lightsabers and then he uses the flamethrower on her. We haven't seen the flamethrower all this season, have we?
Yeah. He uses it
early
at
on.
In the Cobb Vanth episode.
Yeah, that's right. So we haven't seen it since then and it's still... pretty sick to see, especially how it was the lighting and how it was shot in that scene.
The Simbas, can we just say this? I told my dad this. I think this is other than Kylo Ren and Rey fighting on Kefir,
the second Death Star
on the remains
that's
of the
my
Death
favorite
Star.
action sequence shot in all of Star Wars.
That shot of him like coming through the water with
and
the lights
flipping up, the crossguard over.
It's just beautiful. That's number one.
Yeah.
This is a very close number two.
Yeah.
This is all beautiful. The cinematography, all the action was shot
the fight
amazingly.
Choreography amazing. Yeah.
Amazingly well. The colors, it looked beautiful.
And it's a perfect backdrop for white lightsabers.
Yeah, like it's perfect.
It's kind of like why George Lucas went to green lightsabers in Return of the Jedi.
Yep.
He's like, blue won't show up against
the blue sky. You can't see it.
So, yeah, if you had, like, green lightsabers, they might not show up as well on Corvus as you do the white ones.
The white's just perfect.
The white looks so good there.
It illuminates her face perfectly. Like, it's beautiful. It was beautiful.
So then, like, after the flamethrower, he, like, shoots the, like, harpoon wraparound, whatever, the rope thing, and it, like, wraps her up. But then she jumps over a tree and flips that on him. So now he's, like, strung up with the rope. So he disconnects his rope, and she slices open the rope that's got her, like, tangled up. So then
he goes, Sokotano.
Yeah, you get the standoff moment. It's just like when Grief and Cara Dune pull guns on each other.
He's like Sokotano.
Yeah, a little standoff.
Bo-Katan sent me.
Yeah, they both, like, have their hands up. They're like, stop. Like, Bo-Katan sent me.
And she goes, I hope it's about that.
Yeah, I hope it's.
And that was the most Ahsoka that we need to talk.
Yeah.
And she goes, I hope it's about that.
Yeah.
Looking at the child. And I was like, that's Ahsoka. Like, that's when I was like, okay, that's Ahsoka. For whatever reason, that just felt right. Like, her, like, oh, okay, we're good. You know what I mean? Like, this, like, optimistic kind of mentality that Ahsoka has.
Well, yeah, because it's kind of probably the same reason why she gave the Magistrate a day. Like, she doesn't want to kill people, but, like...
She didn't seem like she didn't want to. She was murking those people in the woods.
And she has to, I guess.
Killing bitches.
I mean, she's the only Jedi in Order... She's the only Jedi in Order 66 that doesn't just start murdering clones.
Yeah.
She tries to save all of their lives.
Yeah, that's true.
She goes out of her way to save them. So, like, she doesn't want to kill unless she has to.
The episodes I told you about when I was in Venice that I was like, dude, these are really good.
You really liked the inhibitor chip arc.
So good.
Yeah.
So good. And someone messaged me on Facebook and asked me what my episodes for Clone Wars. I will get them to you. I promise. I got to finish watching
the ones.
Yeah,
I want to do that now that you've got favorites now. So I want to compare them to what I have.
That's number one. I mean, that whole arc of like, that's the best stuff in Clone Wars.
That'd
because
be in
it
my
has
top five.
Such it has such implications for everything else going forward. Yeah. I mean, it's the most... Like, that could have prevented the downfall of the Jedi and prevented Vader
the
from...
The whole original trilogy
could have
wouldn't have...
completely changed it if they had just listened to that poor guy.
Yeah.
That breaks my heart.
It's
all right,
in my top five.
We got to stay on Mando.
It's hard. There's so much going on. And I'm sure we're going to get off topic now when Ahsoka is sitting... It's not a campfire, but it's like, you know, sitting around a campfire in the middle of the woods. So Ahsoka comes over and sits next to the child. And they communicate through the Force, essentially.
I thought he said that he needed her to train him here. Is this before?
At some point in this conversation, it comes up. I don't know.
So
I just want to say
he'd get there and she'd be reluctant to train him.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Then she'd help him.
Yeah,
and then he'd help her and then boom. We called that.
I got,
obvious.
But the day before on Instagram, I was like, that's my prediction is he's going to get there. Ahsoka's going to be reluctant to help. And then at the end of the chapter, Moff Gideon shows up as a cliffhanger. I didn't get that part. But I got the same thing you said.
I think he's going to show up. I think we're going to pick up on Corvus.
Yeah.
And he's just following the trail.
He's just like a day late,
and
a day behind.
I think they're going to... Did they leave Corvus?
Yeah.
They did?
Yeah. The final shots are like the Razor Crest lifting off and Ahsoka looking at them like thoughtfully. And Ahsoka's theme plays. And she kind of has like a look in her eye like... kind of like them. Like, I might help them out. Like, so she has a look on her face. Like, yeah,
I'm
guys.
Betting that you pick right up from that moment. And
what if
Gideon's
he lands
there
and they start
and
fighting
Gideon's
out.
There with the Darksaber.
And Ahsoka and her and Ahsoka and him got to fight. That'd be sick.
That'd be so dope. All right, anyway.
So Ahsoka and the child communicate through the Force. And this is when Mandalorian is, like, kind of shocked. He's like, I can't talk with him. He doesn't speak. Like, how are you communicating with her? And she doesn't, like, just explicitly say, like, oh, I communicated through the Force, or like, oh,
he goes, can you understand
him?
And she goes,
in a way. Yeah. And that's very Ahsoka too.
Very,
like, in a way.
Like, she'll never like, that's in that book, she's very dodgy with stuff.
Yeah.
I love it.
And she then explains the Force in a very Obi-Wan way.
She uses it verbatim.
Yeah. The almost the exact quote.
Force, like, is what gives the Jedi its power. So this energy field created by all the, it's energy field created by all living things.
Yeah. So then we get the name drop. She's like, Grogu was trained on Coruscant.
Is it Grogu or Gorgu?
Grogu.
Grogu.
G-R-O-G-U.
Grogu.
Grogu.
Grogu. Okay.
So he was trained on Coruscant at the temple. So that's pretty
sick. That doesn't make sense to me, though.
No?
I mean,
why not?
Okay. He's already 50.
Yeah.
And we're talking about...
How long ago was Coruscant and the Jedi Temple a thing?
But so he was training at one?
It's not 50 years. He was probably like 5 or 10.
It's 5 years after Return of the Jedi, right?
Yeah.
How many years from episode 3 to that is there?
20.
It's more than 20.
Luke's 20, right?
He's like 25.
In Return of the Jedi?
No, he's like 30 in Return of the Jedi, right?
No. Isn't him and, he like him 22 and Leia are like 20 in A New Hope. They're young.
Still would put him at... I mean, he can't talk. How is he training with Jedi?
Through the Force.
That's the only thing where I was just like, what? That doesn't make any sense.
He would be like... Let's just call him 15 or 20 at the end of his training when Order 66 happened. Let's just say he's like 20.
Okay.
Well, that would make sense, yeah, because this but is 30 like, years later.
Then he would be so, an yeah. infant. I mean, he's still 30 years later. He can't barely walk.
But he's also been hidden and locked away for how many years? So maybe they normally can speak and
Do
walk.
Do we know who hid him away?
No. We're going to find out eventually, I feel like, because Ahsoka was like, somebody took him from the temple and hid him. And she even says he's been like suppressing his power to stay hidden. So I feel like under normal circumstances, by age 50, these things can walk, talk, do everything in the Force. But because
he's laying low,
yeah, because of how crappy his life has been, he hasn't been raised right. He doesn't know how to walk or talk or use the Force properly.
Do you think he's Yoda's kid?
I hope not. I really
it would make
not.
Sense. He's at the Jedi Temple.
It does.
Should names drop Yoda.
It does, but also they have holocrons that have the names of every Force-sensitive child in the galaxy on it. So maybe he was just on one of those holocrons.
Maybe.
And they went and picked him up.
Interesting that she said she only knew one person.
I guess she didn't know Yaddle.
But she's on the council.
At what time, though? Maybe Yaddle wasn't on the council when Ahsoka was involved.
Because she's in there. She's on the council
in the Phantom Menace.
And then
she's
never again?
Not, yeah, she's not after that.
So what the hell was that about?
Doesn't come around for another 3 or 4 years.
That's true. I forgot it was Phantom
Actually,
Menace.
It's more than that. It's like 10 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, see, how was that 10 years? Well, because there's a big gap between 1 and 2.
Yeah,
because
Anakin's right. 9, and then in and Phantom Menace, he's 9, eight. But then in Attack of the Clones, he's like 19 or 20.
They need to give specific ages, because I'm tired of trying to do this weird math.
Yeah. Any math is weird math.
It's
for
all
me,
bad.
So.
But Holly literally said the other day that there was like something we had to do with like a bank account, and you have to solve a math equation. And she's like, what? I just did it because I knew you wouldn't be able to figure it out. I was like, thanks.
That is love
you're,
right there.
You're right. But thanks.
You're so right.
You're so right. We need to get that dropped too.
Yes. That's one of my favorite quotes. But yeah, that's true love right there. She knows. And it's also an insult. But that's okay. That's what love is.
It's what it is.
Yeah. This is sick though. Just so many name drops. And how she even mentions that he's been hiding his powers to survive. It's just like Cal Kestis.
Yeah.
In Fallen Order. Like, he's had these powers, and he's like, how old do you think he is? We don't know his age. He's like a teenager, right? Like 18?
Yeah, he's like 19.
18, 19.
Yeah.
But it's the same idea. Like, he hasn't been trained properly. He's been hiding his powers. He has to relearn his powers as he goes through that journey.
Mm-hmm.
So that was very similar to me.
Interesting you bring that up. Keep going.
Exactly. That's going to come up later in the chapter, at least for speculation's sake. We get a little bit of, like you said, she mentions Yoda. We get Yoda's theme. And that
I
just, like,
it.
Hits me. Yoda's theme is one of the most emotional sound pieces in all of Star Wars.
I love it. It's so beautiful.
Yeah, even just 3 notes get me to tear up. Just a few notes, and it's like, I know exactly what that is.
I'm that way with Leia's theme.
Yeah, those are the two most emotional sound pieces in all of Star Wars.
I've told you the story as to why that is, right?
Yeah, yeah.
The John Williams thing when I saw him live
at Celebration,
and they were playing that as a memorial to her.
Yeah.
Not a dry eye in that month.
There's no way.
Not
if
a dry
you
eye.
Have a dry eye, you're a robot. There's no way. And then eventually at the end of this conversation, I feel like, is when Ahsoka just says, I'm not going to train him. Oh, no, this is later. So the next, she's like, I will train him. Lessons are going to start, like, tomorrow. So
very Luke Skywalker in Last Jedi.
Yep. So she's like, all right, tomorrow we'll start. So then she sits him up on a rock the next morning, and she has a little rock, and she's like, Grogu, take the rock.
Now, does
so
he
she push,
take,
No,
he?
She pushes it over to him.
Okay.
And then he's
then
like,
she
she's
wants,
like, give it back.
Okay, that's what
and
I was wondering.
And he just, like, takes it and he just, like, yeets it on the ground. He's like, yeet. So.
I thought he held on to it.
He does for a second. And he's like, nah.
Oh.
He's like, I don't care. So then she's like, come over here. And Mando's like, no, he's stubborn. And she goes, no, I don't mean him. I mean, you come over here. So then she's like, he's not going to listen to me, but he'll listen to you. Basically,
he goes,
like,
that'd be the first time.
Yeah. Basically, because you're his dad, he'll listen to you, but he won't listen to me because I'm some random person. And it's very Force Awakens when Han's like, Luke's, or Leia's like, Luke's a Jedi, but you're his father. Mm-hmm. When it's trying to get Ben to come back.
Yeah.
Han's like, he wouldn't listen to Luke. Why is he going to listen to me? It's kind of that same thing.
Luke.
Yeah.
Why would he listen to me, Leia?
That's kind of that same thing. Luke's a Jedi. You're his father. Yeah. So Mando doesn't use a rock. He pulls out the little knob. And he's like, here, Grogu, take this. And Grogu takes it from him.
Quickly.
He doesn't hesitate. Yeah, it's like straight to his hand.
So dope.
Yeah. So then Ahsoka's like, okay, you can see it in her face. She's like, you okay? Yeah, you're not bullshitting me here. Like,
God, this so is, cool. Yeah.
So then he's like, see, he's pretty powerful, right? And then Ahsoka's like,
I can't train him.
Yeah, but I can't train him. And he's like, you just saw what he can do. What do you mean? And she's like, yeah, but he's really attached to you, strongly attached to you. And he's like, attachment is not good. She's like, I've seen this in even the most trained Jedi Knight. Like, attachments are not good.
Yeah.
And she's like, I also sense fear in him. And like, that's, I've seen what that Those does. Are,
that's a check, like a
fear. Yeah, it's a checklist.
Is fear that, check.
You got fear, you got attachment. All right. Check. Yep. Nope. Can't do it.
Nope. So you're good.
Yeah. So she doesn't mention Anakin by name, but it's, she's talking about Anakin.
Yeah. Isn't it weird though that like the Jedi, like you can't be attached, but you have a very
compassion.
Close.
You have to.
You have to be compassionate, yeah. But you also have to like you're friends with your master.
You are to an extent though. This is even an arc Ahsoka goes through in the Clone Wars when she gets trapped with Barriss Offee. Anakin is like, we have to go save Ahsoka and Barriss. But then Luminara, who is Barriss Offee's master, is like, nope, they're gone. Like, we got to give up on him and move on. And Ahsoka's like, I'm not going to give up. Anakin's like, Ahsoka's not going to give up, so I'm not going to give up.
Sorry, I didn't mean that.
But
I really didn't. Sorry.
For once, he didn't. But it's that same thing. Like, because it's a fine line between, like, friendship and brotherhood between master and apprentice. So, like, you're supposed to teach each other and care about each other. But, like, if it comes time to cut ties, you got to cut ties.
Yeah. That's so weird.
Yeah. And even Obi-Wan has a problem with it in Revenge of the Sith. He's like, send me to fight the Emperor. I will not kill Anakin. So, like, he can't even go fight Anakin. But Yoda's like, you can't take out the Emperor. You have to go to Anakin. I got to go to the Emperor. And it's the same thing here. Ahsoka's like, I can't have attachment and I can't have fear. And, like, I'm not going to train him because of these reasons. So then, at this point, Ahsoka.
Breaking news.
Oh, boy. What is it?
Dave Prowse passed away.
Oh, I saw that this morning.
I just saw it.
Yeah. At 85, oh, right?
Man.
Age 85.
That's so sad.
Yeah.
Jesus, man.
We're Harrison Ford and Mark Hamill are like about it. We're running out of originals.
That's it from original trilogy, people.
Yeah. Well, Frank Oz.
Yeah, that's true. Thankfully. Sorry, didn't mean to.
And Ian McDiarmid.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Thankfully.
But isn't it weird that he's only in Return of the Jedi?
That's so weird. But then people freak out that Snoke's only in. Basically, he's in Force Awakens, but he's, like, only in The Last Jedi.
I think they did... We'll get back to Mandalore in a second. Sorry. But I think they did such a good job with Snoke just as a character.
I do, too.
They did it the same way they did the Emperor. They introduced him.
Yeah.
And then he's in there for the fight scene.
Yeah.
And to talk shit to his apprentice.
Yep. That's it.
So I don't know.
And Palpatine's only in Episode 9, too.
Yeah.
It's the same.
That's still strange.
He's briefly in Empire Strikes Back, but it's not Ian McDiarmid. It's a different actor.
Yeah.
But they've since went back.
Remastered
and,
it.
Yeah.
But that thing is creepy looking.
Yeah. He's a very odd
It's like one bulging eye. It's very strange. All right. Back to where we were at in Mando.
So is this when... Oh, yeah. So Mando's like, the Magistrate sent me to kill you. And Ahsoka kind of turns around like, say, what now? So this is when we like then cut to the city. So, I mean, we assume Ahsoka and Mando aren't going to, like, kill each other
Cut. They're friendly.
Yeah, they're friendly. But
it's
like,
meant to be a misdirection to the people in the show, not to us.
Yeah, in-universe it is, because, like, to us, it's like, they're not going to fight each other again. So she walks up to the gate, and she...
Do you think Ahsoka could kill Mandalorian?
Yeah.
You think so?
Yeah. Definitely.
I don't know, man.
I think so.
He's quick with that draw.
Yeah. But then again, like, he was down to, like, his last weapon. Unless he has Whistling Birds left. He pulled out his blaster, and that was, like, all he had left.
Yeah.
Versus two lightsabers. Like,
true.
Even though he does have Beskar, she could still cut him where there is no Beskar. There are creases in the armor somewhere. Even though no one can ever shoot him there, it seems like.
Yeah, right?
But that's okay. Whatever. Plot armor. Beskar is literally plot armor. It's fine.
Got him!
So then she throws over his shoulder plate. At the
this
gate.
Is a load of barnacles.
You're having too much fun with this.
It's fun.
I love it, though. It's great. So she throws the shoulder plate with the Mudhorn signet on it over to the gate to be like, look, I killed your bounty hunter. Like, now what do you got, you know?
Ah! Got him!
Yeah, that's what she's saying. She's like, got him. So she jumps over the wall, starts murking people. She cuts through the bell and, like, cuts through a dude in front of the bell.
We forgot to say in the first part where she's cutting down that tree that she cuts into the tree and then throws the a piece of the tree to the
tree. God, that was so dope. The dude in the face.
Sorry.
She is, yeah, yeah. She is not holding anything back.
So dope.
So she jumps over the wall. She starts, like, murking people left and right. And we didn't mention what you wanted to mention the first time you saw the village, the city, is, like, a lot of it is Batuu. A lot of it is Galaxy's Edge.
Looks just like it.
Like the little food bubbles or whatever you want to call them that are like...
I don't know what those are called, but those are dope.
Yeah. Like, it's straight out of Galaxy's Edge.
What if it's in the travel guide?
I bet it is.
I'll have to double check.
Yeah.
I wonder what they're called.
So we get to see the village here again, and right in front of, like, the Magistrate's Palace thing is, like, those dudes in, like, those electro cages. Like, that is
dark.
That
was dark, dude.
That's super dark.
It
reminded
me... super dark.
Probably not other people, but weirdos like me, it reminded me of Pirates of the Caribbean 2. When Jack goes into this, we still don't know what it is. I'd love to find out. To get the drawing of Davy Jones' key, there's dudes in cages that are getting their eyes picked out by crows. Yeah. Like, it reminded me just like that.
Super interesting there.
Yeah.
Super
I don't know.
Super interesting.
I thought you'd have that reaction.
Super interesting.
The ability to speak does not make you intelligent.
I thought you said that was for people on Twitter, bro.
It's for you too right now.
Wow.
I'm sorry. Sorry.
Well, I'm done speaking then. Wow.
I'm sorry. And Evan said,
I'm sure you are.
Okay, you brought me back around. I love this soundboard now. So we get her going in there and murking people. I don't even know when the Mando shows up, but he eventually reveals himself and shows up. We get lots of Lothcats in this village too.
Super cool.
Which I thought was cool. So then we eventually get them all split up. The Magistrate goes and retreats back to her little palace place, and her main bodyguard guy. I kind of like this character. I don't know. A lot of people have been like, I couldn't take the actor out of that character, and he was too over the top and goofy. But
over the top and goofy,
yeah.
What?
Was I don't know. Goofy? I didn't see it. I liked him.
He was okay. I mean, he was a decent background character.
Yeah,
I didn't really
he's
have
good,
a strong
like villain
opinion.
Henchman. I thought like,
he looked to me like a young Kurtwood Smith, the guy who's Red Foreman on that 70s show.
Oh yeah, yeah.
He looked like a young. The actor looked like that. Looked like him.
Dumbass.
I'm gonna shove my foot so far up your ass.
But the Magistrate sends her two, like, security droids with him. And I was like, that can't be good for you. That means you have nothing to protect you, lady. Like, all right. Not a good choice. So then we get her and Ahsoka. And then we get Mando versus this guy, basically. And then, like...
I just realized that she killed her.
We don't know.
She does.
We don't see it happen.
We don't see it happen, but we see that dude get...
Is she dead?
We see the dude get the Magistrate cloak.
But is she dead? What happened to her? We don't know.
She did not kill her.
That's what I was going to... No
she
one
killed everyone else.
No one has even questioned this, except I have it written down, and you just beat me to it eventually. But, like, does she kill her? We don't know.
She definitely does.
Maybe. I don't know.
What did they do? Just, like, put her in the streets? Then everyone else... She died either way.
They should have just shown her in, like, those electro cages.
That would have been sick.
That's what they should have done.
Yeah, that would have been dope.
I don't know, though. Like, did she kill her? Who knows? So we get this sick fight between Ahsoka and the Magistrate Lady.
Slow.
Morgan Elsbeth. I keep calling her Magistrate Lady. Morgan Elsbeth.
You just call her the Magistrate. That's fine.
That's fine. So it's a great fight. It's like just not all action either. They're both sizing each other up. Like it's a
slow burn.
Yeah, it's a slow burn fight.
But it was good.
In a good way.
Because you don't, I mean, you. For me, it's like I got all the cool beginning part. That was the fast action.
Yeah, her.
Let's build the tension here. Let's build this tension and make this like a... First time I was watching, I was like, oh god, is she gonna... Because especially when she loses the lightsaber at one point.
Yeah, she
and loses it goes
one
in the water,
into the water.
I was like, is this how Ahsoka gets killed? Like, yeah. She's gonna die by this
one
Beskar
random,
spear? Like, yeah. So random. But no, she disarms her with the staff, and they're having that conversation outside, like, who's our side?
Mando and the henchman guy.
Yeah,
like, who's gonna win?
My side or your side? And he's like, we're
pretty alike. He's like, we're similar, you and me.
It's just like, willing to lay our life down for the right cause. And he's like, but this ain't it.
Yeah.
And so he's trying to like run away.
Yeah.
Wink, wink.
Yeah, he's trying to like give Mando this false sense of security. Like,
yeah.
Dude, I'm done. Like, this is over. Because he's like, oh, it sounds like you won.
Yep.
So he, like, he lays down his blaster.
And he saw this coming a mile away. And then
because Mando's hand is Western style standoff on his hip the whole time, waiting to draw his blaster.
And then he puts the gun down and whips out the other blaster.
A smaller blaster.
Goes to shoot Mando.
Mando's draw is faster. Yeah.
I think the Mandalorian's force sensitive. There. I said it.
Nah.
I said it.
Would you like
that? I said it.
Would you like
that?
No,
it'd be stupid.
Yeah.
But I'm saying it now.
I hope not.
I'm calling it now. He's force sensitive because he does that too many times for it to be a coincidence.
Just a quick draw.
Is it though? It's always right before the person does what they're gonna do, and that's a
He's been in standoffs, man.
That's what the force powers are. So it's
force sensitive because he shot first. Like
that's stupid. That's not even close to the same thing. That was one instance where he got lucky. He consistently
Han did it in Solo also against Beckett. So it's two instances.
Yeah, but that's obvious too.
It's pretty obvious. This dude, you just said it was obvious earlier.
It was obvious to me, but like I don't think.
So you're force sensitive,
bro. I'm force sensitive as fuck. That's all are I'm
you?
Saying.
You suck.
Sorry.
I'm sure you are.
I'm force sensitive too, bro. You don't even know.
I'm sure you are.
Shut up, Ben. I don't know, dude. It just seems like it's constantly with this narrowly getting away. It's a bold statement. It's wild.
It's a very bold statement.
It's bold, but I'm calling it now. Like maybe he was initially, and that's why he was on the run from those droids. They were trying to kill him in the first place.
Maybe. Could be.
I don't know.
It could happen. Like we've had weirder things happen.
The ability to speak does not make you intelligent.
I don't fair know enough. Who that's
like fair,
that's
it was you. Me, fair enough.
So yeah, Ahsoka wins, and then Mando wins, and then Ahsoka gives Mando the spear. And Mando's like,
No. You are missing the biggest plot, the reveal of the whole show.
Oh, you're right. Yeah, go
so
ahead,
she,
you got it.
So she goes and wins the fight and goes, tell me where your master is.
Right.
Which, what the fuck does that
and we're
mean?
We're like, does that mean she's working for Gideon?
That's what I thought.
Like, all right, that's cool.
And she goes, tell me where Thrawn is.
Grand Admiral Thrawn is.
So specific.
Yeah.
Not like another character named Thrawn.
Yeah.
Where is Grand Admiral Thrawn? And I was like, oh!
Yeah.
And I was like, looking at my dad, I was like, he's like, who the hell's that?
He's like, so?
I'm like, it's Grand Admiral Thrawn. I'm like, the blue guy. He goes, oh.
Oh.
Yeah.
The blue guy.
The guy from the last episode. I was like, no, Dad. No.
Not the Mithril. That's
literally what he said.
Wow.
And I was like, no. The Grand Admiral from the show. And I was like, you need to watch Rebels.
Yeah. And so like, that would mean, like, okay. That explicitly means she hasn't found Ezra.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So she's still looking for Ezra to this day.
She found him at one point and dipped out. I have a theory. Are you ready?
Why would they dip out, though?
I was talking to our buddy Thomas.
Okay. And I was too on Instagram.
Yeah,
he said
that he was gonna probably the thing I mentioned before.
Okay.
In passing.
Then definitely. Yeah.
But I think you're gonna find Ezra with Thrawn, and Ezra's gonna have switch sides. There I said.
Oh, Tom and
I. There
we didn't
I
talk
said
about
it.
That.
Stockholm syndrome.
That would be so.
Stockholm
sick.
Syndrome. Cal Kestis. Not Cal Kestis. Ezra Bridger.
Ezra Bridger. That would be sick.
Yeah,
dude.
Yeah.
Because right now, Mandalorian has a villain problem. We don't have any villains, so.
We have Moff Gideon.
Eventually, maybe.
You are so salty about
it
this.
It is, man. You can't build up this villain then have him do nothing. He's going to do
the
something.
The show's not over yet.
I know, but
you got to give it time. You got
tired
three
of
full
I'm
episodes
impatient.
Left.
Three, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, three, and he's going to be in every single one of them.
He better be.
Guarantee you're going to see him next episode.
Better be.
I'll put $100 down. You're going to see him next episode.
Nice.
Want to take that bet?
No, I'm broke.
All right, it's fair.
I hope that is
totally fair.
You suck!
Yeah, I do. Well, okay. Thomas and I talked about something completely different.
I bet he
that.
Told me, so I know what it was.
Yeah, I'd love that, though. That would be sick.
Yeah, I think you're going to see Ezra. Because,
so
I mean,
she's still
that's
searching
what Stockholm
for
syndrome is.
So maybe her and Sabine have, like, split up to help search for him. Because the last we saw them was they were together going to find him.
Oh, can I tell you how stupid it is that that kid exists for between Hera and Kanan?
Oh, yeah.
That doesn't even make sense.
How not?
Was she pregnant already?
Right before Kanan died, man. They
went hard in the paint. Yeah. He could sense it coming.
Yeah.
And then he was...
She could sense it coming.
we're going to move on.
That was a perfect time for a... Yep, there it is.
Jesus Christ.
Yep.
Hera got banged out.
Wow, you said it. Yikes. I'm not thinking that at all.
Hera got banged out.
So after the Grand Admiral Thrawn reveal, where us nerds nerded out.
Got cracked open.
That shows Ezra's out there somewhere. We're still looking for the Purrgil. What if we see Purrgil? Are you going to...
Fuck no.
No? You're out?
That's those space whales, right?
Yeah, the space
whales. I hate those fucking things.
Well, we might see them.
I hate them. I hate him.
I hope we see
shit.
Him.
I hope we don't.
I hope we see him.
That's the Dave Filoni crap. That and the wolves. Like, just leave nature out of it.
Yeah, I kind of get that. The wolves to me are goofy.
It's not as goofy as the space whales.
No, but that could make sense.
Space whales that can also go hyperspeed.
If there's a creature living in space, they have to do it somehow. They got to get around somehow. It makes sense.
It doesn't make sense that there's whales
in
space
in Star Wars. There's whales in space in Star Wars.
That's all fine It's that.
There's a giant squid in the maelstrom in space in Solo. Like, there's a lot of things that are goofy.
Yeah, and I don't like that either.
I don't like the maelstrom either.
I would love
the maelstrom. I just don't like the squid in the maelstrom.
A Millennium Falcon Smuggler's Run mission where you go through the
Kessel?
Maelstrom.
You go to Kessel?
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be sick.
Be dope. Anyway, So
after the Grand Admiral Thrawn reveal, which was already huge.
Okay, let's break this Grand Admiral Thrawn thing down real quick. Okay, so last we know, everyone keeps saying they go to the unknown regions. Where is that said? Because it's not said in the episode.
No. Where is that said? That's a good question.
Because everyone keeps repeating that like it's a thing. And
because I think that's probably people just extracting the fact they know the Empire and the First Order are in the unknown regions.
You can't say that without knowing.
Yeah, that's
so
just assuming.
That's, I kept watching this and I was like, we don't know where they're going.
We don't know where they're at. Yeah, I guess it is unknown, but it's not the unknown regions.
But see, I was under the assumption that it was the unknown regions.
It could be.
So that would make sense. And this is what me and Thomas talked about. If Thrawn goes to the unknown regions with Ezra to help build the First Order with the Emperor, because he is very... This actually might not have been Thomas who I was talking to this about. I don't remember who it was. Might have been my friend Chase. I don't remember. I'm so sorry. I am so, so sorry.
You suck!
Fair enough.
I'm sure you are.
Yeah, it would have been a good one too. I'm under the assumption that Thrawn is out in the unknown regions getting ready to build the First Order for the Emperor because he's very loyal to the Emperor because the Emperor would give him and the Chiss immunity, I guess.
Which is so weird because the Empire was racist. But like the Chiss are like
he's the only he's the highest ranking non-human person in the Empire.
Yeah.
And he's an amazing strategist. Yeah. And it's just an all-around badass. I don't see... Do we know how long Chiss live?
No, we don't.
Okay. So it could be one of those things where they live for a long time.
We haven't seen many Chiss to begin with, except for in the books, the Thrawn books.
Yeah. I don't... And I know they're all born Force-sensitive, and then that power fades.
And the ones they keep around are Skywalkers.
Yeah.
And the younger ones are better at Skywalking than others.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's what they literally call it when they can navigate space is Skywalking.
So stupid.
And they navigate it through the Force.
So dumb. But that's what I think. And I think... Cool.
And you think Rae Sloane is out there with him?
Yeah.
That'd be sick.
Do we know where Rae Sloane is from?
I don't. I'm sure it's on Wikipedia. I don't know.
Dope. Hang on. That wouldn't make sense because she's in the Empire, not the... I was gonna say
this kind of jumps to... what's your dream Mandalorian, not cameo, but character? We've already got Bo-Katan and Ahsoka, so that takes them out.
I got what I want.
When you got Snoke.
Snoke would be my number one.
But you don't want him bursting out of the tube. No. Yeah, you don't want that. But you've got Snoke a little
I want it confirmed that it's him. Did you see that there's a visual dictionary coming for Mandalorian?
Mando?
Yes.
Ooh,
I just saw it this morning.
I haven't seen
it. Comes out in July.
Sweet.
So I'm assuming it'll be season one and two.
Yeah, definitely.
So that'll be very cool and helpful.
Yeah.
I love
names for these characters. Actually, the unnamed Mandalorian. Let me try again. The unnamed Mandalorian in chapter 12, right?
The one with Bo-Katan episode.
That guy, his name. 12, right? Or 11.
Was there an in-between episode?
Siege was in between. It was Eris, the Siege, which was the Snoke episode.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So it would be 11.
And then, yeah, this one. So the unnamed male Mandalorian, he does have a name. His name was Axe Wolves.
That's a dope name.
Yeah. So the visual dictionary will help with things like that, but he does have a name.
Cool.
So thankfully.
Love it.
But that would be sick. So, I mean, you've already got a little bit of Snoke. It's not confirmed, but we got Bo and we got Ahsoka.
I'm convinced it's Snoke.
Me too.
It's definitely a nod.
Yeah.
Like a Snoke.
Maybe that literal one we see in the tube isn't the one we see in The Last Jedi.
Correct.
But it's an iteration at making.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, what character would you love to see, though? You have to pick just one. You can only get one.
Luke Skywalker.
You would. So, Dave Filoni's right here.
No, I take
And you're pitching
it back.
A character to Dave. What do you tell
him? I take it back. Lando Calrissian, Donald Glover.
Okay. That he was in Rebels, so he knows Ahsoka.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay.
But
that'd be sick.
But
I would love that.
Tied into something
I
else,
love Donald Glover.
But it's tied into something else that we get at the end of this episode. So let's finish this up.
Right.
Write down Lando so we don't forget to talk about this because I have a reason I say that.
Ooh, I think I know. I like it. So we get, she's done with the fight. Maybe she killed the magistrate. We don't know, whatever. But they've given the magistrate title to this one guy who you told me is somebody big. I've seen him before.
He is a Disney legend.
Oh, shoot. Then I'm an idiot for not knowing this.
He was a major executive with the Walt Disney Company.
What?
Yes. His name, I want to make sure I get it right because I, you know me, I'm a complete idiot sometimes.
Well, I am because I didn't know who this was.
Wing Chow.
Okay, yeah, I know I've seen him.
And he was a vice chairman of Walt Disney Parks and Resorts for the Asia Pacific Development, as well as executive vice president of Walt Disney Imagineering.
Whoa.
Where he oversaw master planning, architecture, and design for Disney properties around the world, including California, Florida, Hawaii, Tokyo, Paris, and Hong Kong. I'm pretty sure he's the guy behind the Grand Floridian. I can't. I don't remember specifically.
So he's been around for that long.
Yeah.
Not just like recently.
No. Wow. He's the real deal, and he was that character.
That's pretty sick.
Yeah, very cool. I can't find this anywhere, but I'm pretty sure that he. We'll have to really look this up and talk about this on the Disney Parks podcast that we do, but I'm pretty sure he was behind the Grand Floridian.
That's sick.
I'm pretty sure. For some reason, that stuck in my head, and I feel like I'm right, but I could be wrong.
He's now the magistrate of, I forget the city's name, on Corvus.
Yeah. Does the city have a name?
Yeah, Bo-Katan named it. It was like Caladon or something
like
that.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
So he's now the magistrate of that city.
And then the Mandalorian goes to give Ahsoka the child, Grogu.
Before that, Ahsoka wants to give Mando the Beskar spear.
That's
he's like, I didn't earn this. That wasn't part of the deal.
Right.
And she's like, no, like, you need it. It belongs with the Mandalorians. So he takes it a little reluctantly,
and he's even like, okay, yeah, I'll go get him. Like,
yeah.
Sadly.
Oh yeah. He's
my
like,
my dad
yeah.
pointed that out. He's like, he said that like really reluctantly.
Yeah. He doesn't want to give up the child or Grogu at this point.
Grogu.
We can finally say it. But also this getting the spear gives him, aside from his armor, a weapon against the Darksaber. Because if Gideon tried to fight him right now, he could only block him with his arm, you know, but now he has the spear, so it gives him a weapon to counter Moff Gideon and the Darksaber. So then he saunters back onto the Razor Crest. He goes and gets Grogu, and he's like, it's time to say goodbye.
Yep, and it's this sweet moment where he's like,
because Ahsoka did agree. He's like,
and some time passes. You can see that he's been sitting there for a little bit with
him. He's snoozing up in his little
his little hammock.
His
is
little
so
hammock.
Cute.
Yeah, the Grogu hammock. And because Ahsoka agreed, she's like, okay, if you help me take out the magistrate, I'll train Grogu. So he goes and gets him. He walks back over to Ahsoka. And then Ahsoka's like, never mind. I can't train him still. And Mando's like, seriously, again?
Come
like,
on.
This part of the deal. Like, everyone keeps
doing
this.
I held up my end.
Yeah. Like, he's like, everybody keeps doing this to me. Like, every time I go on a mission, someone sends me on a new mission. They change their end of the deal. I hold up my end of the deal. He's a little kind of pissed off. And you can kind of, I kind of get that. Because it feels like every episode is just Mando helping others, going somewhere new. Mando helping others, going somewhere new. But that's kind of the way the show is. It's set up as a
episodic thing,
journey. But Ahsoka's like, I can tell you what you should do with him. And this was very
interesting to me. This was my favorite part of the episode.
Yeah. Ahsoka tells them to go to the ancient Jedi temple on Tython. And she's like, put Grogu on the seeing stone at the top of the mountain, and a Jedi may come looking for him if he reaches out through the Force.
So that's why I said Lando. Because we know at this point in time, Lando's jumping around with Luke.
They're looking for Jedi
artifacts. Jedi artifacts and temples. Do you think we get a Luke Skywalker cameo with Sebastian Stan?
I don't know.
I don't think it's possible. I mean, it's a really cool thing. It's a cool thing to say.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen.
No.
I think what's going to happen is that's when Ahsoka comes back.
Okay. That could happen. But, I mean, the Jedi we know that are alive around this time period. I started off with the obvious ones. I was like, obviously Luke, obviously Ahsoka. But then I started talking with Thomas, and we were like, wait a second.
Your boy.
Cal is around.
Yeah. Is he?
Yeah. We don't know if he's dead or not. We can assume he's alive.
I think there's going to be a Jedi Fallen Order 2 come out soon.
Yeah, so that's all the more reason where Cal's still alive. It could be Cal. Could be technically Seer, also in Fallen Order. She's a Jedi. She's around.
I don't like that character.
No, I like Seer.
Nah.
I like Seer better than Cal.
No, I like Cal way more.
Wow.
Cal's cool.
And you could even, it could be the same actor that was Cal, because he already did.
I like Cal more because he's white.
And he's not a woman. Seer's a woman.
It's what it is.
It is. Jeez. I said I like Seer, so
we're just kidding.
Are we?
I mean, I am. You fucking about racist.
What? Whoa, I'm not. No, I'm kidding about the woman part. I think maybe. Wait, is Seer Jewish? If so,
we're going down a real weird road here, bro.
Yep. Anywho, so what was I gonna say? Shoot. Oh, you could even get the guy that played Cal to do Cal
because it's him.
He did motion capture. They got his. It's his face in the video game.
Yeah, you could.
And he's perfect. Like, yes, that'd be sick. And they did the same with Seer.
Yeah.
The voice actress for Seer, she's in Galaxy's Edge VR.
Oh, really?
She's the Corrin bounty hunter.
No way.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. She's kind of a badass in that game, too.
That game is going to be fun. I want to get an Oculus Quest so bad.
It's like, what, a couple $100? Like,
300.
That's actually not bad.
Nope.
No.
And that's all-in-one VR. You don't have to have a computer for it, either.
Whoa. I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
Whoa.
We should go have these.
So we got...
Because that's the only reason I want it is for that.
Yeah.
That and that game where, like, you walk across the plank and if you fall, you die. It's fun.
Only you. So yeah, like I said, I started off with the real basic ones. I'm like, Luke's still alive, Ahsoka's still alive. Like those could be the Jedi that show up. But
it's
then just, I started.
It's gonna
talking,
be Ahsoka.
It could be, but I started talking with Thomas, and he goes, "Well, does Leia count as a Jedi?" And I was like, "Yeah, like she was doing Jedi training."
Whoa.
Leia could show up. I don't think so, but it's a possibility.
I don't think they would do that just because of Carrie Fisher being gone.
Yeah.
I think if she was alive, they would just de-age her.
Just get her daughter, though.
That's amazing.
He's a genius for saying that. I was like, you are, like, that's a brilliant question. Leia could be an option. I already said Seer and Cal. And
but didn't she quit training at this point? Because they're on
around,
Kef Beer.
It's around this time. Because Ben was alive, because she's like, she sensed the death of her son at the end of her training.
Yeah.
So Ben is around in that flashback in episode 9. And at this point in time in The Mandalorian, Ben would be 4 years old.
Flashback in episode 9?
In episode 9.
You see
9.
Him?
No.
Oh, I'm just saying he's around. You see him.
He's alive.
I miss?
Okay. I wish. But no, he's alive at that point. I just don't know how old he is at that point.
You need to read Last Shot if you want to see baby Ben.
I do need to read that. But so we know at this point in Mandalorian, he's 4 years old. So I don't know if this is in the middle of Leia's training, if it's after her training. If it's after, then no shot.
See, that's why I want Lando to show up.
Yeah. He'd be perfect, but how is he going to know?
They explicitly... Well, he'd be with Luke. You just wouldn't see Luke on screen.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah.
But that would be such a tease.
That'd be cool. That'd be cool. But Luke would be sick. Leia would be sick.
The reason I say Luke over... I would rather see Luke. Let's just be very clear.
But okay.
We have a young Han Solo already.
Yeah.
Who's also been under contract for more movies and stuff.
Yeah.
This could count as one of those things. It would be a big deal. It would get people back interested in Solo.
Right. We could see Chewie at some point, too. I mean, if you see Chewie, you see Lando and Han.
What if it's just some other... It would be probably... Just, like, if I don't want a new Jedi. That's...
No, but there's...
Because that would mean someone else survived Order 66.
There's one Jedi and one grandson of a Jedi who has Force powers that we haven't mentioned.
Who?
Carr from Force Collector. And his grandpa,
oh,
Nock
dude,
Med.
If it's Nock Med or Carr...
That would be sick. I don't know if Carr's alive at this point, though. It's close.
He'd be young. Well, no, because the first time we see him do anything would be from Force Collector.
And he's like 15.
Yeah, and
he's
that's
a kid.
That's way after all this.
Yeah, so Carr's not around.
But if
but
it's
his grandpa,
grandfather?
Nock Med.
Well, no, because he was in hiding, remember?
Yeah, I mean, he could have went into hiding after this. So he could have been like, I'm hiding, and then he gets called to this, and he goes, and then he goes hiding again.
That would be amazing. Dude, could you imagine?
But they've
been doing stuff like that with these random characters. It could happen.
Yeah. I feel like Cobb Vanth is more, mainstream. He's not mainstream, but he's more mainstream than Nock Med. Like, more people have read Aftermath than have read Force Collector, even though Force Collector is
a
way
better
book.
It's not even close.
It's not even close.
Force Collector is one of the best.
And we're not
Star
just
Wars
saying
books.
That because Kevin was on the show.
No,
we love this
anytime
book.
Anytime I
before.
Get someone on the show, it's because I like them.
Yeah.
Notice how I didn't get Alexander Freed on the show.
No.
Now, I don't dislike Alexander Freed.
As
I met
a
him.
Human,
he's a
like,
nice
yeah.
guy.
As a guy, we love him.
I don't like his writing style.
Yeah, we just didn't like the book.
And I don't need to go on and talk shit about someone's book to their face. It
yeah,
just
that would
rude.
Not. That's not good listening. That's it's not good
no
things
to
do as a. Yeah.
I'm not a bad person. I don't want to make anyone feel bad.
Well, you're not, but I am.
You're a terrible person. It's fine.
Yeah. Is that your? That's the go-to one. That's your favorite
that's
one.
That's my favorite one.
Yeah.
Or
after I say I'm a bad person, you can say, I bet you are.
I'm sure you are.
All right, yeah, wow. Did I just butcher it?
Or just go,
you suck!
There you go. But Nakhmed would be sick. I don't think it's going to happen, but I would lose it if that happened.
That would be my favorite because it would just be, to a lot of people, it would just be this new Jedi.
Only like 5% of people watching it would know, I feel like.
I doubt
who all
is
Red
high.
Force Collector? Like,
I don't feel like,
sadly,
I don't know.
Not enough people.
I know, and it's such a good book.
Yeah.
So much thought went into that book. I love how he wrote the book, and they're like, nope, you can't do that. That's episode
He's
9.
Like, he
wrote
episode 9. He's like, because it's in episode 9.
Because
like,
you wrote the plot for episode 9 in this book, and we can't have that.
Yeah, but as we said when we talked to him, we loved all his tie-ins, too. They went to Utapau, they went to Batuu, they went to places from the sequels. He went all over. It was great. And that's how I think it needs to be done, instead of random planet number 6, random planet number 45.
Season 3, do you want to see Batuu?
Yeah, I'm going to see it in season 1. Season 2.
Would you really wouldn't think that's like a cash, like just an obvious?
It is no matter what, but I want to see it.
He like walks into Oga's.
Oh, that'd be nice.
So lame.
Gets a fuzzy tauntaun.
Then like, then like that would be, like whatever seat he sat at would be like the Mando seat.
You're right. Everybody would want to
charge
sit in that
more
seat.
For that seat.
Oh, they would and they should. They would.
The Mando seat.
Yeah, it'd be like a VIP package. You want the Mando VIP package?
Oh Jesus.
Yeah.
With like a Mandalorian coaster.
And when you walk in, everyone coaster. In the bar has to go, "Hey Mando!
Hey Mando!" Did you realize that that's the name of the music? The theme is called "Hey Mando."
No.
Yeah.
No, it's not.
I promise you.
Ludwig named a track "Hey Mando."
It's called "Hey Mando."
Did he listen to the show?
No, it's because it was episode one.
What?
It's the title is called "Hey Mando."
No,
I swear to God.
Like
look,
Nama Hey Mando.
No,
like Nama
Hey Mando. Even with the exclamation point.
No.
I swear to God, I'm not making it up. Chapter one. It's called
Why?
Hey Mando. I had no idea it was called Hey Mando.
I didn't either. Oh, my gosh. Ludwig, we need to talk, bro.
What's he called that before we did?
I know.
But I had no idea it was called Hey Mando. I was looking up Mandalorian music while I was reading because I like to listen to Disney music or Star Wars music while I'm reading.
That's too fun.
Or I listen to Brown Noise. Just keeps me focused.
Yeah.
But it was like, it was Hey Mando. I was like, is that their podcast on iTunes? And I was like, oh, that's what the theme's called is Hey Mando.
That is too funny. What are the odds?
I had no idea.
That's
I
so
had
weird.
No idea. I had no idea.
Jeez.
Okay, so.
Okay, but.
What are your actual predictions for what this is going to go, how this is going to go down? With the child and the.
Well, the ancient Jedi temple on Tython.
What if it's Ezra?
We've talked about this a little bit, but it's already canon. This temple and this planet are already canon.
Have we seen it before?
In a comic. In the
What's
Afra
it look
comics.
Like?
It's
an Afra comics.
Yeah, it's
which
a
ones?
Snowy
I have a bunch of those.
It's one when she teams up with Vader because Vader and her go to Tython.
I have a few of those. I haven't read. I need to see if I have those because that'd be really dope.
So that kind of made me a little happy because I'm like, if you've listened to the show, you know I hate how there's a new planet every day in Star Wars. So at least this is one that already exists. We haven't made up Ice Planet Number 5, even though it is another snowy planet.
I need a little Hoth now in my life, exactly. A little bit of Tython by my side.
Don't Ilum in there.
A little bit of Ilum's what I need.
Jeez. So, but that's cool to me. I was like, okay, we're throwing in a planet that already exists. Thank God. We're not going to Corvus, another new planet. Like, it's just something that's already here.
I like the new planet thing because every once in a while they nail it with a planet like Corvus.
Yeah.
Now, if when it's like the same aesthetic, it's like, okay, we didn't need Jakku and
Tatooine.
Passana.
And Passana. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. Takodana is another like forest planet. So it could have been.
Takodana has its own feel to it.
Yeah, it does. Because it has a little bit of like water / a little bit of mountain.
It's like if Seattle was a planet.
Yeah.
All right. What's your actual prediction for this? So they go to Tython. They put the kid down. He reaches out through the forest. What happens?
I don't know. I mean, Ahsoka was so sure like an actual physical alive Jedi will reach out. Back.
I think it's just going to be her showing back up.
But it could be a vision. You never know. And it's also, she was like, he will choose his own path.
I think he's not
like
going
to
choose.
What if Grogu decides not to do anything? What if he gets there and he's like, nah.
Yeah, I think that's what's going to happen.
That could happen.
But isn't that kind of, it has to be because we don't see him anywhere.
Yeah.
As a Jedi.
It could be. And then, I mean, I don't know though, because we got to get Gideon too. And I'm not saying that because I want him, but I think the way the storytelling works is he has to show up soon.
Here's what I think is going
to
happen.
What if he tracks the Razor Crest to Tython
and
blows everything up?
Blows the temple up. That's what I think is going to happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That'd be sick.
That'd be so cool.
Okay, so that, and also Ahsoka does show up, and she gets involved with a fight with the Dark Troopers and with Gideon on Tython.
And then they were showing her being ruthless for a reason.
Yeah.
It wasn't just to show her being a badass.
Now, see,
unless it was.
Well, yeah, it could be. But what if she pulls the ultimate Jedi move here and sacrifices herself to save Din and Grogu on Tython?
Do you think that they would kill all, like Dave Filoni would not let someone else ride off Ahsoka's death? I don't think so.
Well, do we know who? Well, I mean, I'm sure we do. Who's written the next episode, the next chapter?
I don't want to look.
Because I know this one was written and directed by Dave.
I think it's the only one by him this season. Yeah. Written by him.
And also, I mean, yes, that would make her like the ultimate Jedi thing, but that doesn't complete what she wants. She wants to find Thrawn and Ezra.
Yeah.
So.
That's her story to me.
Yeah, logistically, she shouldn't sacrifice herself yet because she needs to find Thrawn and Ezra. And then she can pass away, whether it's naturally or sacrifice or whatever. Or maybe not. She doesn't have to die. We don't have to see her die. You know, we don't need to see every character die.
Yeah,
it's not how
we don't.
No. So that's what I would think, though, for chapter 14, right? 14, 15.
Chapter 14.
No. Yeah, right? Yeah, 14, yeah, 14. 15, 16. Yeah. They get to Tython. Grogu reaches out. Ahsoka shows up. Gideon shows up. We get a battle. And it's a badass episode, and it's my favorite one so far.
This one is?
No. The next one's going to be.
No.
Yeah. So far, still the Siege is my favorite.
I think it's my favorite too.
I feel like we're in the, which is nothing wrong with that, but I feel like we're in the minority on that.
Everybody
loves
are.
The Jedi. Like the Jedi is everybody's favorite.
Well, it's because it's Star Wars and it's Ahsoka, and I get it, but I don't know. I wanted more from it.
Yeah.
I don't know what I would want. You know what I mean? Like I was expecting a little more out of it. But I don't know because it checked off everything I want.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with it.
No, not at all. But
it gives us everything that we want and that makes sense.
And I think this is the episode that's given us the most information.
Yeah.
By far.
By far.
Like
clear
information.
It gave us Grogu's name and his backstory and what to do with him next. It gave us like his whole story. His past, present, and future.
I just can't get over the fact that he was trained at the temple on Coruscant. Like, that's crazy.
Yeah. I wonder who
I wonder who saved him. You think it was Obi-Wan?
Who saved him? Who? Obi-Wan?
Obi-Wan? He wasn't there.
No, Obi-Wan went straight to Mustafar. Well, he went to Padme and then straight to Mustafar.
Cal Kestis saved him.
No, Cal Kestis wasn't on Coruscant during Order 66. He was with his master on a Star Cruiser.
But what if someone sensed it?
Somebody could have, but he
maybe he's like just a Jedi.
Cal was like,
or something.
He's like 10. Like, there's no way he was going to go.
We could save a kid.
I mean, he could, but you remember the scene in Order 66 from Fallen Order? He's like yelling and screaming and crying and wailing and going through so many emotional states. Like
no,
he
I don't remember.
He would not be in the mental state to go, okay, I got to go back to Coruscant, save a baby, and then go hide. Like,
yeah, I don't know. I want to know who was at the temple at the time. Jocasta knew?
Ooh, yeah, she was. That
she seemed
sick.
Like the kind of person that would save.
Yeah, that would be sick. I don't know if we'll ever see it in a flashback or find out officially. But that would be amazing.
That would be dope.
She needs more stuff. Like, she's good in the Vader comics.
She's good in Clone Wars.
Yeah, that's true.
She's
good in
really
Clone Wars.
She's really dope in Clone Wars. And that scene with the changeling and
I forgot all about that.
What's the Cad Bane?
Yeah. Holocron heist.
Yes,
right?
That's
good early
arc.
On.
That's a good arc, too.
And that's the Holocron that has the names of every Force-sensitive child in the galaxy, which could involve Grogu. So she probably knew those the names of those children. Maybe she saved him. That would be sick.
Well, he would be there already.
He'd be, on Coruscant, but maybe she saved him during Order 66.
She knows how.
Because she survived Order 66.
She does?
So, yeah, because she fights Vader later on.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Duh. Well, one of the best episodes of Mandalorian. I think maybe my third favorite this season.
Do you like the Bo-Katan episode better?
I need to rewatch them again.
We've had 5 this season so far. This is my second favorite.
I still love the Cobb Vanth episode.
That's probably my third.
I think it's still my favorite. It was just so cool.
Yeah.
And it just set the tone.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
It kind of did. So it was like, okay, like get ready. We're dropping a lot of knowledge. We're dropping Cobb Vanth and then Boba Fett and then Bo-Katan and then Ahsoka, then Thrawn, then Grogu. Like we're dropping everything.
I think it's a good move. I knew we'd get it this. I knew we'd get his name this season because Bob Iger said he knew the kid's name already.
Okay. Yeah.
In an interview,
he said like it has a name. He hasn't accidentally slipped it. But
he said, "I know the."
Yeah, he's like, "I know the kid's name.
I know the kid's name." So yeah, I really enjoyed it. I'm really excited
like his
for
name.
Next week.
Like,
oh,
yeah.
By the way,
I think it fits. I
think it's totally cool.
Yeah.
It's Grogu. I mean, it's distinct. It's not going to get mixed up with something else. There's nothing else that sounds like it.
Yeah.
I love it. Anything else you would like to add
you
to this?
You suck!
Sorry. Wow. Anything else you'd like to add to this?
Well, not after you insult me like that.
Sorry, I didn't mean to. When the screen turns off, you can still hit buttons and it plays. Yeah. So I'm trying to like wake up the computer and it's like, you suck! Anything
you
else you'd
get
like to add?
The soundbite from Happy Gilmore. You suck, you jackass.
You jackass.
Yeah, jackass.
That'd be a good one.
That'd be a good one.
Anything else you'd like to say before we wrap this up?
No, I'm excited. I mean, whether or not she finds or sees or gets Ezra and Thrawn, do you think Gideon ends up killing Ahsoka eventually? Or do you think Ahsoka lives? Or do you think somebody else kills her?
She's such an important character. Something has to happen to her. Maybe she's old age.
Yeah.
Between... Yeah.
But
now
also, she's not in episode 9 except her voice, which doesn't mean she's dead. That bothers
but
me when people are
like,
all
the other Jedi are dead, though.
That's true, but that doesn't mean she's dead. Like, that kind of bothers me when we're like, oh, she's got to be dead because everyone else was. But I'm like, she could just be alive and communicating through the Force.
But I don't think that's a thing that happens.
It is.
Because
Luke and Leia communicate through the Force, and they're alive. Luke and Vader do it. They're alive.
Yeah, but not as a spirit, though. It was very, like, it was...
Every other Jedi
is dead in that.
Yeah.
I can't imagine that she's alive and she's the only one like, you can do it, Rey.
She could be.
I'm over here not helping.
That part does suck. It's like, you got this. Have fun.
Right, but like, that's what I'm saying. Like, it doesn't make any sense that she would be alive and not helping.
Yeah, that part does not
so
make
I
sense.
Think for sure she's dead. I mean, even Anakin talks, which is weird.
Yeah.
Did we ever discover why they haven't just told Kylo Ren that Ben changed?
Wait,
Anakin changed?
I mean, who would tell him that he would believe? Luke, he wouldn't believe Luke.
At one point, he would have.
At one point, but they were hiding that from... Well, I mean, they were hiding Rey's lineage from Rey. Leia and Luke both hid it from her. And they were also hiding Ben's lineage from Ben.
But, like, after he finds out, wouldn't you just be like, but he changed. He realized that it was not the way to go. I don't know. That was always weird to me, where it's just like, tell him.
Yeah, we don't get that in the comics. We need more Ben Solo comics.
I would love
the
Ben
one
Solo.
The one we have are really good.
I would love a Ben Solo comic book.
Yeah.
I think it'd be really cool. I didn't love the Knights of Ren. Or the Ren.
The original guy.
Yeah.
The Ren, who's the leader of the Knights of Ren.
Yeah, I didn't need all that.
Yeah. It gets
a little
weird.
I think it would have been just cool if there were just students from his school that weren't as powerful as he was.
But then that makes them Force sensitive too. Which,
okay,
I don't know.
That's fine. But powers fade over time.
That's true. That is
so,
true.
So, you know.
That would have been cool.
And he could have like made sure they didn't use the Force to be stronger than him.
That would be pretty cool too.
Or I'll kill you.
He like manipulates them.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
That'd have been cooler. Anything else you'd like to add about episode 13, The Jedi? Do you have a title? Prediction for the next episode?
Ooh, that's a good question. It could just be the Jedi again. The Jedi Returns.
I have the Return
of the Jedi. Oh, wait, we can't do that.
I have a title.
The Second to Last Jedi.
The Temple.
The Temple, that's a good one. Yeah. Yeah, I like that one.
Or The Path.
The Jedi Steps.
Doo-doo.
Nope, it's just called Chapter 14, Hey Mando.
Hey Mando. I couldn't believe that when I saw
that's
that.
That's still wild to
it's
me.
It's so funny.
But I'm going to Batu tomorrow. Cannot wait.
Sweet. I haven't been yet. There's something you needed me to grab for you.
True.
You still want me to?
Yeah, please do.
Tuesday, okay.
Yeah.
Can do. All right, brother. Let's wrap this up. Thank you so much for watching. We appreciate you guys listening to us every
time. Has anybody responded to lightsaber quiz?
I haven't checked, honestly.
I want people to respond so bad.
I
want to give away that you guessed and I guessed and I want to... Ah, so bad.
Yeah. I haven't checked. I probably should. Whoops.
It's all right.
Thank you guys so much for listening. We will see you next time. Until then.
The Force will be with you always.
I don't like that. Let's do it like
it's
we were
right.
going to do it.
I like
Until
us
then,
saying it.
May the Force be with you.
Always.